and of all that you are is not all you desire. And of all that you are is not all you desire. And of all that you are, it's not all you desire. And of all that you are, it's not all you desire. Then come, come alone, come with fear, come with love, come however you are. Just come, come alone, come with friends, come with foes, come however you are. Just come, come alone, come with fear, then let go, come however you are. Just come, come alone, come so carefully close, come however you are. Just come, come along, come with sorrows and song, come however you are. Just come, come along, come let yourself be wrong, come however you are. Just come, come.
Grace and peace from the one who was, who is, and is to come, Jesus Christ, our risen and reigning Lord. We are glad that you have joined us for our online worship service here at St. Andrew's Covenant Presbyterian Church. For our in-person services, we are pleased to announce that the nursery will now be available for the 11 o'clock services beginning on Sunday, July 25th, and then on August 1st, we'll begin to offer an 8:30 a.m. worship service in the chapel. Also, communion will be celebrated at both services that Sunday. Rich Richards, our non-traditional music and worship director, his last Sunday will be August 1st for in person, but we'll continue with our online worship services through the end of the month. If you haven't already done so, we hope you'll check out our new website and download our new church app from the App Store or from Google Play. And as we reopen for in-person gatherings at the church, we are looking forward to people to serve. The newsletter offers a variety of opportunities for worship and service and education and nurture. But if you're not sure where you'd like to serve, we encourage you just to speak with one of our staff members in the area that perhaps you're considering, and we'll be glad to help you discern where your gifts can be best put to use. Also, please check out the website and newsletter for the latest news and opportunities at the church. And if you're interested in connecting with our church, and we hope you are, please go to our website, sacpc.org, and share your contact information with us. Now we're pleased to welcome Tom and Kim Dalton, who will have our moment for mission on Eden Village.
Hey, good morning, St. Andrew's Covenant. I'm Tom, and this is Kim Dalton. We've been members here since 2001, and we're working on an incredible community called Eden Village of Wilmington. And Eden Village will be a tiny home community for the chronically homeless, living on the streets of Wilmington for over a year. It's a reasonable target. We're not curing all of homelessness, but there are about 100 folks that fit this this category, and we want to strategically begin to help them get, as a doctor and a nurse, what we believe is better health care through housing. The best way to house folks is through tiny homes.
So our personal journey with Eden Village began after a mission trip to Kenya in 2018. Tom and I had done numerous mission trips over the past 25 years, but this mission trip was different. I asked Tom not to go into the hospital where he felt most comfortable, but to come down and be in the village with the people. So after about 2 days working in the slums outside of Nairobi, we were just heartbroken and felt hopeless. And after a lot of tears and prayers, we decided that we wanted to come back and truly make a difference every day in the homeless community.
Yeah, so I've always taken care of homeless people in the hospital. And I noticed that we would see the same people over and over again. And I just thought we could do a better job. Managing medical illnesses for folks that are on the street is very difficult. Basic diseases like diabetes. Your insulin needs to be refrigerated. High blood pressure. You got to have medicines to take. Simple wound care is very difficult to manage on the street. And we would see people coming in. There's one guy that was admitted to our hospital 240 times in a 3-year period. I just think that we can do better. The life expectancy of somebody who's living on the street is about 30 years less than yours and mine. And so that's what really stimulated us to get going from the medical side of things.
And the neat thing that we see, of course, God is in every detail of our lives, and he showed up big and loud in this one. One of the really cool things is as we started looking for tiny home communities and tried to model those, God circled right back to Springfield, Missouri, where Tom and I both were born and raised. And a lot of great people have come out of Springfield, Missouri. Rob Lapp, Nate Stratman, Brad Pitt, and now Eden Village. So that was super special. We also, as we began to talk to the director of Eden Village, the founder of Eden Village, his brother actually lives in Wilmington, North Carolina, and he is an accountant. And he came online with us and has helped start the project with us. So that was really cool. And then something that was really touching and special to me, as we went and visited Eden Village in Springfield, we started driving down the road, and we finally got to the property of where Eden Village of Springfield is, and I realized that's where my grandparents had managed some property there, and I grew up as a young girl sitting under the shade tree with my grandfather as he sat there reading his big old Bible. So it's so cool that God knew that way back then, and now it circled us back into our lives.
Yes, God has certainly had his hand in the very short process of Eden Village of Wilmington. We have come a long way. We're starting construction out on the site. We have 4 homes that will be delivered each month starting in 2022, and we hope to have residents next year out on the site. We've done that with some amazing people, many of them right here in this church, who have faithfully stepped out, and we would invite any of you to come and get involved with us. We believe that dignity is the best solution to poverty, and the community is the best solution for homelessness. Eden Village matches a dignified community for these folks who are in need. So if you want to get involved, go to our website at edenvillagewilmington.org. Hit the donate button, hit the volunteer button. Just watch some videos and learn more about what's going on right here in our city as we imagine a city where no one sleeps outside.
And beloved, now let us call ourselves to worship. We give thanks to you, O God, for you are good. Your steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I might come through them and give God thanks. Lord, we believe. Help our unbelief. Let us pause now to examine our hearts and our minds and confess our sins to Almighty God. Shall we pray? Almighty and merciful God, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. O Lord, have mercy upon us and forgive us our sins. Amen. Now let us take a moment for silence and for personal confession. Beloved, if anyone is in Christ, that person is new altogether. The past is finished and gone. Everything is fresh and new. Believe the good news of the gospel, for in Jesus Christ we are a forgiven people. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hey everyone, how are you? This morning our scripture is from the book of Philippians, and it talks about following Christ's example. And one of the things that Christ was humble. Well, what does humble mean? Well, to be humble means you don't draw attention to yourself. You're not trying to be better than everyone. You're trying to be loving and caring and thinking about others first. Not that you don't care about yourself, but you're more concerned about others. And that's what Compassion Camp has been all about. So it really fits perfectly with the scripture this morning. If you remember, those of you who've been watching Compassion Camp, we talk about our superpower being loving kindness and living as Jesus would want us to live, humbly and caring for others. We talk about seeing people's hurt, feeling people's hurt, and easing people's hurt as we help them. That's the example that Jesus gave us, to show loving kindness to all people, no matter whether we know them or not, near and far, praying, doing what we can, jumping in, and showing the whole world love and compassion, following Christ's example. That's what Jesus asks us to do. So this week, let's all look for ways to be humble, to be caring, to reach out to others, not for us to get attention, but simply to show God's love. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you that you have taught us by example how to live, how to love, and how to show kindness to others. Please help us to look for ways this week to show your love, and to jump in when people need help, to love people and care for them. And all God's people said, Amen.
Hear God's word as recorded in Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and in earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. In my speaking, in our hearing, and especially in our doing, let us be faithful to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I love to play tennis. For more than 50 years, tennis has been a major source of entertainment and recreation and exercise. Both of my sons played high school tennis, and I enjoyed watching them play. I've also enjoyed watching major tournaments on television, such as Wimbledon. Since I've come to Wilmington, I've played in the United States Tennis Association leagues and in the Wilmington Tennis Ladder. A major part of tennis is the serve. When two players are fairly evenly matched, they will usually win their own serve. And when they have the opportunity to choose to serve, as at the beginning of a match, they will do so. In life, however, people don't readily choose to serve. Serving is often seen as a disadvantage, a detriment, instead of an advantage or a benefit. There are two major reasons why servanthood, or serving others, is unattractive and unappealing to most people, including to many Christians. The first reason is cultural. Our society tends to picture servanthood very negatively. We connect servanthood with slavery, which was a huge blemish on our national character, and involved much degradation and suffering for its victims. Or we connect it with the service rendered by those recently arrived immigrants to America called indentured servitude. Today, we tend to picture servants as pathetic creatures, virtually without any purpose in life, as bent over and crushed in spirit, as lacking self-esteem. Our culture does not encourage us, therefore, to be servants. Instead, our society proclaims a very different message. Commercials tell us, just do it. Why wait? Obey your thirst. Got the urge? Be selfish. Instantly gratify your desires, regardless of the consequences. We live in an age of gross selfishness when books on the subject sell millions. We're encouraged to seek self-actualization, to set and achieve personal goals, to win the prize, to pursue success. Sometimes we're even taught to use other people, if necessary, to achieve our goals. You can't change the world, our culture proclaims, so look out for number one, grab as big a piece of the pie as you can, build up your own empire, be comfortable and affluent. Our culture, therefore, teaches us that servanthood is demeaning and unfulfilling. We should seek to be served, to be prominent, to be successful, rather than serve others and meet their needs. This cultural message strongly supports a second reason why we don't want to be servants. Being a servant goes against human nature. By nature, we are sinful and egotistical. We want our own comfort and happiness before we care about the happiness and comfort of others. So the idea of servanthood goes strongly against the grain. We're naturally very receptive to cultural messages that encourage us to be selfish. Despite these obstacles, we must seek to be servants for three major reasons. First, Scripture commands us to do so. Deuteronomy chapter 10 says that God requires us to serve Him with all our hearts and souls. Our primary reasons for existing, our principal role in life, is to serve the Lord and advance His kingdom on earth. Consider these scriptures. Romans 7, we serve in newness of spirit. 2 Corinthians 4, we are bondservants for Jesus' sake. Ephesians 4, God has given us gifts to equip us for the work of service. 2 Corinthians 3, we are servants of a new covenant. Hebrews 12, offer to God an acceptable service with reverence and awe. And 1 Timothy 4, Be a good servant of Christ Jesus, constantly nourished on the words of faith and of sound doctrine. Second, we should seek to be servants because of the example of Jesus Christ. Jesus did not come to be served, to grab the spotlight, to occupy the center ring, to make a name for himself, to attract attention, to become successful or powerful. Jesus expressed his love for his disciples and for us through his service. In response to Satan's temptation in the wilderness, Jesus declared, "You shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Jesus, who had all the power of God at his disposal, chose to use that power not to dominate, not to control, but to affirm, encourage, lift up, enable, and serve others. According to Philippians 2:7, Jesus took on the very nature of a servant, which was very evident throughout his public ministry. We are to be servants because Jesus was a servant. Philippians 2:5 tells us to have the same attitude Christ had. We are to follow his example. He is our model. According to Christ himself, what most brands us as his followers is our love for and service of others. This is the principal identifying mark of discipleship. It is not our knowledge of Scripture, not our style of worship, not the rituals we perform, not our membership in any specific organization, not even our theological orthodoxy or the depth of our spiritual experience that primarily marks us as Christians. Rather, it's the service we render to others that is the distinguishing and demonstrating mark of our commitment to Jesus Christ. A college professor, over many years, asked students about who their most memorable teachers were. In almost every case, those most remembered and appreciated as teachers were ones not who had the most knowledge of their subject or ones who had the most innovative teaching methods. Instead, the ones who made the greatest impact on their students were the ones who displayed the most love, who had the most servant-like attitudes. A third reason we should seek to be servants is because of the many benefits that come both to the church and the world through our service. As we serve one another, we promote harmony within the church. We provide a positive witness to the world, and we help our church to grow. As we serve others outside the church, we help bring them to Christ and help meet their physical and spiritual needs. As we seek to emulate Christ and be servants, we will advance God's kingdom and make the world a better place. We are called to be servants. How can we fulfill this role? What qualities or characteristics do servants need? Philippians 2:3 tells us to do nothing out of selfish ambition, in humility to consider others better than ourselves. Being humble means having a modest opinion of ourselves. We're to do nothing from selfish motives or conceit. We're to reject self-seeking and sinful egotism. According to Philippians 2:4, we're to look out for the interests of others. Is it possible to respect others too much, to appreciate them too much? Because believers have been given a variety of talents, we can always find something in other Christians to appreciate and admire. We can always recognize some place where they excel. Romans 12:10 commands us to give preference to one another in honor. Galatians 5 declares, through love, serve one another. Christ provides the perfect example of how we should behave, of humility, self-renunciation, and concern for others. A good servant does all she can to make life better for those she is serving. A servant's first interest is the welfare of others. A good servant is conscious of others' needs. He loves others. He knows what pleases them. He has a genuine desire to help them. He's willing to subordinate his own needs to theirs. He has the fruit of the Spirit described in Galatians 5. The qualities of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control are all very valuable to servants. If we exercise these traits, these fruits, we will undoubtedly render good service to others. Servants look for ways to support, encourage, build up, and stimulate other people. They would rather give than receive. They're willing to give generously, voluntarily, and personally. They do not expect to be rewarded or even acknowledged for their service. They do their work quietly and effectively. Good servants are also very forgiving. They don't hold grudges. They're able to forgive and forget. They're not easily offended or insulted. They know that forgiveness helps bring people together, that it heals hurts. Servanthood fulfills many biblical commands: to be kind to one another, not to judge one another, to pursue peace, to care for one another, to forbear one another, to be tender-hearted toward one another, to comfort one another, to build one another up, and to love one another. Having examined the qualities Christians need to be good servants, the final question is, where should we be servants? The simple answer is everywhere, in all our roles in life. We should be servants of one another in the church, of others in our neighborhoods and communities, through our vocations, servants of our spouses and of our children or parents. Through our work, we can glorify the Lord and serve coworkers, clients, and customers. Colossians 3 tells us to work heartily as unto the Lord, that it is really Christ that we are serving through our work. Would we approach our vocations any differently if we thought of them primarily as means of serving other people and those we work with? Would we treat those we have responsibility over any differently if we thought of ourselves as their servants? To what extent would the qualities of servants we discussed be beneficial in our work? And how about being a servant in marriage? In the past, women often were expected to serve their husbands, to wait on them hand and foot when they were at home, to pick up after them and be at their beck and call. After all, men were the breadwinners, and the Bible told women to submit to their husbands. Well, the times have changed. Cultural expectations about women's role in the world of business and in the home are different. A large percentage of women work outside the home, and most women desire to be equal partners with their husbands. Today, in many marriages, there is no concept of servanthood. Each spouse is trying to get as much for himself or herself as possible. Each is committed, first and foremost, to seeking their own benefits. In many marriages, both spouses feel overburdened with responsibilities and angry about it. Neither feels that she has enough time to relax or do the things she enjoys. So in many marriages, a battle is being fought, a power struggle is taking place, and generally, women are still losing because even when they work full-time outside the home, studies show they do 80% of the housework and most of the nurturing of children. Biblical teaching on servanthood encourages us instead to outserve our spouses rather than seeking to have them do more work than we do. We're to put each other's needs first, exercising the characteristics of servants, working to benefit one another. In a recent survey, two things people said they most value in a church are good biblical teaching and volunteer opportunities. We're blessed to have both of these things here at St. Andrew's Covenant Presbyterian Church. So if you're looking for ministries, organizations, or schools to volunteer with or in, we have great options. You have heard this morning already about Eden Village and its service to the chronically homeless. You can work with them. You can also work with other ministries that aid the homeless, including Good Shepherd and Vigilant Hope. We also partner with ministries that aid the incarcerated, that help people pay their bills for rent, utilities, and medicine. You can work with people who are victims of domestic abuse, child abuse, or human trafficking. You can help provide services to international sailors who visit the port of Wilmington. There are numerous opportunities to tutor children in both elementary and high schools. Our Go and Serve team needs new members as we maintain our relationships with many community organizations and our ministry partnerships with the Chulachisema Presbyterian Church in Malawi and the Petropolis Presbyterian Church in Manaus, Brazil. Moreover, we'll be building our sixth Habitat house in the last 3 years, beginning in September, just a couple blocks away from our church. Your help is needed there as well. In addition to greatly benefiting recipients, volunteering provides many physical, psychological, and spiritual benefits. Numerous studies show that those who help others have a greater sense of purpose, focus less on their own problems, experience more happiness, and feel more self-confident. Volunteering enables us to meet interesting individuals, develop friendships, and have challenging and meaningful experiences. So watch for announcements on Saints Alive or talk with me about volunteer opportunities. It's definitely not easy to be a servant. The disciples had a tough time. They repeatedly jockeyed for position, maneuvered for favor, and argued about who was the greatest. Being a servant takes incredible inner strength, the strength that only God can provide. Servants have no special power in themselves. Servants struggle with everyday problems. Servants are not protected against all perils. Servants will frequently feel tempted to be used, feel used and unappreciated. Often, they will do all the work and someone else will get all the credit. Servants work faithfully and diligently, yet the glory and reward goes to others. Servants must remember that most good deeds will be unnoticed and unrewarded, that our rewards and satisfactions generally will come from within and from God rather than from without. Servants will struggle with being disrespected, ignored, and taken for granted. They will often have to deal with feelings of resentment. Astronaut James Irwin was part of a crew that walked on the moon. He spoke of the thrill of leaving Earth and seeing it shrink in size. En route back to the planet from the moon, he realized that many would consider him a superstar, an international celebrity. Humbled by the awesome goodness of God and God's majesty, Irwin reasoned that his role on Earth should be not to be an international celebrity, but to serve God faithfully and diligently, to share what he had experienced that others might know the glory of the Lord. So when he returned, he created an organization called High Flight that gave him opportunities to share Jesus Christ with leaders around the world. Can we say the same thing? We too are God's servants, created by him and equipped with many good gifts to serve him energetically and creatively in many capacities to which he has called us. Being a servant isn't easy, but in the final analysis, serving in life, like serving in tennis, has advantages for us, for others, and for God's kingdom. Have this same attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a bondservant. Whose service is it? It's yours, it's mine, it's ours. Amen.
When you're weary, feeling small, when tears are in your eyes, I will dry them all. I'm on your times get rough.
Just can't be found like a bridge over troubled water. I will lay me down like a bridge over troubled water. I will lay me down.
When you're down and out, when you're on the street,
as we turn to the Lord with our prayers this day, we celebrate that Julia McLeod Barclay will receive the sacrament of baptism on Sunday the 25th. Her parents are Brian and Hannah Barclay. Her brother is Warren, who is 3, and grandparents in the church are Dr. Warren and Linda McMurray. We're pleased that Bill and Pat Hardy celebrated their 59th wedding anniversary on July 22nd, and Denny and Linda Smith will celebrate their 50th on July 31st. We extend our Christian sympathy to the family of Francis Prunty, who died on Sunday, the 18th of July. A memorial service will be held on Sunday, the 25th at 3 p.m. here in the sanctuary with a reception following. Also, the family, we extend our sympathy to the family of Emily Marquise, the younger sister of our River Ministry translator in the Petropolis Presbyterian Church of Manaus, Ricardo. She died on July 20th after a month-long hospital battle with COVID-19. We also want to undergird Larry Toto, who's scheduled for a heart catheterization on July 27th. Sheila Wood's brother, Bruce Simmons of New York, who suffered a stroke and has had surgery, but he is currently sedated and on a ventilator. Vicki Lapp's mother, Dorla Wagner, of Elkin, North Carolina, is hospitalized for heart issues and is under hospice care. And Catherine Brandy's brother-in-law, Richard Robertson, is battling a kidney stone and infection. Let us take these and our other joys and concerns to the Lord in prayer this day. Shall we pray? O holy God, how can suffering come to an end? How can pain ease? How can grief ebb? Hunger be satiated, weapons laid down, anxiety calmed, corruption fought, division overcome. Your promises to provide and a path of hope you lay out, O God, sometimes seem impossible under the weight of our woes, yet we still pause to pray. We turn to you to speak to you, to shorten the distance between us and you, and the hope and the faith that you listen when your people pray, that you love, weep, act, grateful for your ear, O Holy One. We lift up our prayers to you. May those in need of healing, O God, experience your sustaining presence. May those in need of courage find inspiration to face the day. May those in need of reconciliation find empowerment in your mercy. May those in need of guidance discern your insight and wisdom. May those in need of refuge find a safe place to call home. Eternal One who blesses all of life, bless and renew us all, for time moves so fast, life always ahead of us, urging us faster and faster. May this moment of prayer help us to pause and hear the wind whistling through the trees, to feel the warm embrace of the sun, to see the stars flaring, smell the salty air. May this moment of worship help us to remember and support and sustain all that we have with you and with each other. Oh Lord, we especially pray for those who've been affected by and who are combating the rise of the COVID cases and the spread of the Delta variant. We pray for health and healing. We pray for those affected by natural disasters, wildfires and floods. Be with them as they rebuild. Be with first responders. Be with them and support them all the day long. And Lord, we celebrate with the Barclay family and welcoming Julia into the family of God through baptism. And for Bill and Pat and Denny and Linda as they celebrate milestone anniversaries. We pray for those who grieve the passing of Francis and Emily. May you comfort those that they love the best. And we pray for healing for Larry and for Sheila's brother Bruce, for Vicky's mother Dorla, and for Catherine's brother-in-law Richard. Yes, Lord, in your mercy, hear the prayers of your people, even as we are bold to pray the prayer your Son taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I charge you to be a good servant of Jesus Christ so that his kingdom will flourish and others will benefit. And now receive God's benediction. May the love of God the Father, the grace of Jesus Christ the Son, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you always. Amen.